Behind me, you can see what is known as the Ghost Tower, a replica scale model of what was the northwestern tower of the United States Arsenal that stood here on this site in the 19th century. In 1836, Captain James Andrew Jackson Bradford came to Fayetteville to choose a location for the construction of that arsenal and decided to place it upon this hill that had a command overwatch of the town. This site was a part of local memory and state and national significance during the most trying period of American history. Its story lives on today, guarded by these ruins and told through the people that called Fayetteville home. The town of Fayetteville had always been a crossroads for North Carolinian farmers and commercial interests because of the Cape Fear River. The hope for expansion grew as people learned that investors planned to build a major railroad and an arsenal in town. Following the War of 1812, the United States realized they lacked the proper defenses and means for distribution of troops and supplies, and so embarked on a plan to build fortifications and arsenals along the eastern coast. There was not a single arsenal of first-class storage or general manufacturing capabilities between Washington, D.C. and Augusta, Georgia. On April 19, 1838, the cornerstone for the United States Arsenal in Fayetteville was laid. Captain Bradford wrote the War Department about the ceremony.
"I take great pleasure in being able to inform you that the cornerstone of the North Carolina Arsenal was most happily and satisfactorily put in position yesterday afternoon."
The excitement and economic opportunity of such a large project was a source of local support and pride. During peak phases of construction, the arsenal site employed over 200 free and enslaved men, women, and children. Compared to the population in the 1840s, that would be the equivalent of one local business employing over 18,000 people today. Those peaks and opportunities varied, however, according to national interest, funding, and internal social dynamics. Fayetteville had always been a diverse town that benefited from a large, skilled workforce. However, when outside interests, such as the federal government, looked to employ those locals, they realized that most of them were free and enslaved African Americans. Captain Bradford and others sent here to work on the arsenal were not accustomed to relying on such a diverse group of people for day-to-day operations. He wrote the War Department again, hoping that they would allow him to hire white laborers from the north.
"With respect to workmen, none are resident here or in this neighborhood, except for a very few of the most ordinary skill. They are chiefly free Negroes and slaves."
Planning and development of the arsenal required specific considerations and measures be taken that not only fulfilled national defense needs, but acknowledged a more troubling concern for domestic insurrection. The main arsenal building was one of the first structures to be completed and was regarded as a potential citadel and last defense against locals. The structure of the outer walls were not meant to defend against the regular army, but acted more as a deterrent to local insurrection, as Colonel George Talcott expressed during a visit in 1844.
"If constructed with embrasures for 4-pound guns or 12-pound mountain howitzers, as I would respectfully request may be permitted to be done, when armed with either, would give confidence to the people and effectually overawe the peculiar class, the blacks of this population."
Their concerns and sentiments would have been influenced by recent events in state and national civil rights. In 1831, Nat Turner, an enslaved man from Virginia, revolted, freed others, and killed over 60 white men, women, and children. In 1835, the North Carolina Constitution was amended to further restrict the enslaved and take away the right to vote from all free black men in the state. Although Captain Bradford did receive permission to hire from outside the local area, work rosters and correspondence throughout the arsenal's 20-year construction list the numbers, names, and accounts of the enslaved men and free black laborers that worked at the site. During the raising of a joist at the main arsenal building, Captain Bradford wrote,
"It suddenly slipped from the slings and, falling upon a black laborer, injured him so that he died within half an hour. This was the first accident of any kind we have had."
Work on the arsenal continued, but it never fully operated as a federal arsenal of construction. Local transportation failed to develop as promised, and the decision to build the arsenal in Fayetteville was regarded as a mistake. Though downgraded to an arsenal of deposit, and now overlooked as having any strategic value to national defense, the United States arsenal in Fayetteville was the site of growing tension and fear, as it was still an intimidating structure and represented the government, as did the armories in Springfield and Harper's Ferry. In 1859, John Brown, a white abolitionist, coordinated an attack on the Harper's Ferry arsenal in Virginia. Although he was quickly subdued, with him was a free black man named Lewis Leary, who was originally from Fayetteville, North Carolina.